Hey, how's it going everyone? This is White Pointer, and it's time to dive into some interesting video game history again. It's been a while since I've done this kind of thing, and I've missed it, because I really enjoy doing it. Anyway, in this video we're going to be investigating the Super Nintendo port of Wolfenstein 3D to dissect exactly how it worked, and you may be surprised at the truth. This version of the game cops a lot of crap, and yeah, it wasn't great. It looked really pixelated and blocky, all of the blood and gore was removed, all references to Hitler and the Nazis were replaced, including making the enemies speak English rather than German, and the dogs were replaced with giant rats. Despite all that, it actually runs pretty damn well for the most part considering the hardware, and it's really clever how they managed to pull it off, so let's take a look. So, a bit of background first. I'm sure you know what Wolfenstein 3D is, which was released on the PC originally in 1992. Developed by id Software, it wasn't the first game to be a first-person shooter, but it was the first really popular one, and it was a smash hit for the still, at the time, small team. Up until this point, most first-person games like dungeon crawlers were single-screen at a time, but Wolf 3D managed fast and seamless animation as you explored the mazes of hallways in the game. Lead programmer, the man with a massive brain, John Carmack, achieved this by using a technique called Raycasting. No, not ray tracing, that's something completely different. Raycasting is basically a technique that converts a flat 2D image, like a map, into a 3D perspective. It's not actually true 3D, it's just made to look like it's 3D, and is sometimes referred to as 2.5D. It works by casting out invisible rays from the player's position until they hit a wall, then calculating how tall that wall should be rendered based on the length of the ray. So, the closer the player is, the taller the wall is. Being one of the earliest implementations of the technique, the raycasting engine in Wolfenstein 3D is understandably pretty simple, as there are no variations in wall height, and everything is using nice squares and right angles. Later games that used raycasting were more advanced. That's about as far as I'm going to go with that explanation, but if you want a more technical breakdown of how raycasting works, I'll leave some links in the description for you to check out. This is how Wolfenstein 3D worked on the PC, and it's commonly believed that, logically, this is what the various ports of the game used as well. But that's not actually the case with the Super Nintendo version. After landing the contract to port Wolfenstein 3D to the SNES, id Software then subcontracted the job out to an external developer, like the majority of the other ports of the game, while they worked on their next title, Doom. However, less than 2 months before they were supposed to deliver the final build to publisher Imagineer, the developer had not only failed to give them anything substantial, but seemed to drop off the planet and go MIA, unable to be contacted at all. So, the team at id needed to immediately halt their work on Doom and whack the port together themselves. They discovered pretty quickly that SNES hardware didn't have enough grunt to use raycasting like the PC version did. At least not with a playable frame rate.
Not with that attitude.
John Carmack started going through all of his books, research papers, VHS tapes, and whatever else he could find to get some ideas for a solution, and landed on BSP, or binary space partitioning. What this means in a nutshell is that the scene is divided into two, then each piece is divided into two again, and then two again, and so on, until the entire map is split up appropriately into simple geometric shapes. So, using this diagram from Wikipedia as an example, we have a shape A that is split into B and C. B is then split into D and E, and D is then split into G and F. Ideally, however, you want both sides of the tree to be roughly equal. This creates a tree that can be easily and quickly traversed, drastically reducing the load on the CPU and making the game faster. It does this because the BSP tree is generated by the developers and is already included in the map data, so it isn't done by the game when it loads. You can then determine what the player can and can't see, and how big things should look, based on where they are on the level. So objects closer to them include objects further away. So if the player is standing in segment G, for example, they should not be able to see anything in segment E. Again, I won't dive any further into the technical details as that's not really the goal of this video, but I'll leave some links in the description if you want to learn more. Armed with this knowledge, the team rewrote the engine to use BSP trees instead of raycasting, which was enough to get it running on the Super Nintendo. So then, you might be wondering, if the game used BSP, then why does the title of the video mention Mode 7? What does that have to do with this? Have I been clickbaited? Excellent question. This is where the super clever part comes in. The entire game is using Mode 7.
What?
As you may be aware, the SNES had 8 background modes, numbered 0 to 7, each offering a number of features and sacrifices. It's the final one, Mode 7, that is the most famous, and was used for rotation and scaling effects. You often saw it applied to games like F-Zero and Super Mario Kart to create a pseudo 3D effect, but it was applied in other ways too, such as making world maps and creating some cool effects and levels and boss battles. It's important to keep in mind that this only applied to the background. It couldn't rotate and scale sprites, and the restriction was that it could only use one of the Super Nintendo's maximum of 4 background layers, plus the sprite layer. Whenever you see a game that appears to be scaling or rotating a sprite, that's actually the background, and everything else in the scene is a sprite. This is why, whenever you see Mode 7 applied this way, the background is usually completely black. The problem with Wolfenstein 3D on the SNES was that even though BSP allowed it to run nicely, it ran at a resolution of 112x96, which is really low. The id Software team used the Super Nintendo's built-in Mode 7 to scale the game up to 224x192, much closer to the native resolution of the console, with basically no performance penalty. So yes, this means that essentially the entire game, apart from the player's hand and gun and the HUD overlays, are rendered to the background, so they can be scaled up with Mode 7. You can easily see this when you turn off Background Layer 1. Everything goes black except the gun, player face and HUD text. It's not just the environment that's on the background, but the enemies, collectibles and everything else is too. Even the blue bricks behind the HUD are on the background. Turning off the sprites turns off everything else, showing the game is only using 2 layers. So, everything in the main viewport is drawn to a single background layer at a low resolution, then scaled up using Mode 7. It's not an effect that you generally associate with Mode 7 for sure, but it's there, and it's really clever. While this was a very cool solution to get the game running reasonably well, this is also the reason why it looks very pixelated. It's because everything is being scaled up. It's also why the gun and status elements are a higher resolution, because they are sprites that are not being scaled. But they managed to deliver the game on time, despite the extremely tight deadline, managing to knock it all together in about 3 weeks, incredibly. Interestingly enough, when the studio returned to working on Doom, they decided to take what they'd learned from the Wolf 3D SNES port and use BSP trees for that too. If you want to learn more about the engines powering Wolfenstein 3D and Doom, you can read more about them in the books Game Engine Black Book Doom and Game Engine Black Book Wolfenstein 3D by Fabian Sanglard. So even though this particular port of the game isn't finally looked back on for the most part, you can now take some time to step back and admire the really creative software engineering that went into making it possible. That's it for this video, so give me a thumbs up if you liked it, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!